Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to the Sarawak Cultural Village for the World Harvest Festival 2017. This evening, you will be entertained to a theme play entitled Tra Tra Land, Where Honey Sparkles. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, before we begin our theme play today, may we have the pleasure to invite Yang Berhormat Datuk John Siki Anak Tayai, Assistant Minister of Native Laws and Customs and Assistant Minister of Arts and Culture Sarawak, joined and accompanied by Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dato' Amar Dr. Haji Abdul Aziz bin Dato' Haji Hussein, Chairman of SCDC, to the Lake Platform for the official launch. Ladies and gentlemen, to officially launch World Harvest Festival 2017, we invite Yang Berhormat Dato together with Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dato' Amar to beat the drums 3 times. Ladies and gentlemen, the World Harvest Festival 2017 is now officially launched. We once again thank Yang Berhormat Datuk John Siki Anak Tayai, Assistant Minister of Native Laws and Custom and Assistant Minister of Arts and Culture Sarawak, together with Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dato' Amar Dr. Haji Abdul Aziz bin Dato' Haji Hussein, Chairman of SCDC, for officiating the World Harvest Festival 2017.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, in conjunction with the World Harvest Festival 2017, the Sarawak Cultural Village would like to present a folk tale from the Bidayuh community. This drama is based on a mythical ancient story about romance, unity, and harmony with a touch of magic. We present to you
Tra Tra Land, Where Honey Sparkles.
About a beekeeper that succeeded in making his own empire by pioneering the honey. His name is Jura.
Far, far away in the midst of a rainforest, there was a peaceful Bidayuh village where the people like to work in groups in the true spirit of Gotong Royong, either in the gardens, farms, or fishing in the river. They also enjoyed sharing meals among themselves while exchanging stories about their daily chores. Some like to learn something new, and they also love to dance.
Not far from the longhouse, there was a grandmother named Nyukit and her grandson named Jurai, who lived in a small hut. They were so poor that they worked day and night to make ends meet. One day, Jurai wanted to play with the other children, but he was so shy. A little girl named Dayang approached him and invited him to play by the river. When Dayang's mother saw Dayang, both of them, she quickly Dayang. Ran towards them.
Dayang! Aduh, dah nak opot itu say. Dik kedengar. Tati mo dia. Tati. Oh, si dapuk mawah dua hari itu. Kat tati, rikas. Mau nam tak pun tak nak nak dia.
She quickly grabbed her daughter's hand.
Dik kedengar tak nak dari itu say. Dia miskin, botak.
Telling her that she should not be friends with Jurai because he was poor.
Mat, mo ya ke? Dikini ngasih danya. Mat kebori.
She also scolded Jurai and told him not to come near Dayang again.
Sus, dikasnya mat. Mat main doh yo.
Jurai felt rejected and cried.
Grandmother Nyukit saw Jurai crying and decided to bring him back to their little hut. While walking, she told Jurai that no villagers cared for them, for they were poor. She advised Jurai to stay at his mother's longhouse, which was at the other side of the hills, if things go wrong. Grandmother Nyuket and Jurai went to the jungle to collect some wild tapioca for lunch. While Grandmother Nyuket was digging for the tapioca, Jurai went to the nearby river to fish.
While Jurai was fishing, Grandmother Nyuket went into the jungle and never returned back. Jurai went back to the hut and found out that his grandmother was not around, and he started to look for her. He called and called, went into the jungle, but no trace of her. Jurai cried and went to see the chief of the longhouse, asking him to help searching for his grandmother.
Mana merana? Jaga-jaga pun jaga ini. Senoki moti. Muka eksumuk muka.
But the chief decided to do the searching the next morning as it's getting dark.
Ada pengaruh. Tes pagi sejak kali. Tes pagi kali. Ya. Boria. Tes pagi prana. Ada memori.
Jurai went back sobbing until he fell asleep.
The following day, early in the morning, Jurai went to the jungle searching for his grandmother. Upon reaching the river, he was exhausted and decided to take a rest. Suddenly, he heard someone calling for him. He was convinced that it was his grandmother Nyuket. He ran towards the voice and stumbled upon the tapang tree.
He found out that his grandmother had turned into the tapang tree where wild bee built their nest at the branch. Then, his grandmother taught him a special song, Bigumba, whenever he wants to climb the tree to get the honey, and asked him to make a flute made from a deer's foot.
After hearing this, Jurai went back to the village and told the chief what had happened to his grandmother. He quickly left the village for his mother's longhouse at the other side of the hills. Meanwhile, the chief and his men went to the tapang tree, but ran away as they saw the tapang tree was guarded by 7 monsters. As time passes by, Dayang, Jurai's childhood friend, turned out to be a beautiful lady and gentle in character. The beauty of Dayang was extraordinary that it lightened the dark path. No other woman could match her beauty.
Jurai grew up to be a very handsome man. His arms were strongly built and limbs were muscular while calves bulged. He was also a hard-working hunter looking for wild animals and products in the jungle.
As Jurai always returned to the village, he sometimes looked for Dayang. One day, Jurai saw Dayang and her friends bathing at a nearby stream. He was fascinated with her beauty, and he fell in love with her. While bathing at the river, Dayang suddenly slip off from the jetty and drown. Jurai quickly swam towards her. And rescued her.
Jurai told that his longtime friend, Dayang, was surprised to meet her childhood friend once again. She also fell in love with Jurai. From that onward, both of them always meet up with each other.
One day, Jurai gave Dayang a ring as a sign of their true love. But from afar, two young men from the village saw Jurai and Dayang together at the river. They quickly informed Dayang's parents of what they had saw.
Dayang's parents went to the river. They would never let Jurai marry her daughter. Dayang were forced to go back to the longhouse. And Dayang's father told Jurai that he should never come back to the village and never meet Dayang again. Jurai was so sad when he heard the decision. He went out, left the village, and straight to the Tapang Tree. He made himself a flute made from a deer's rib that he killed. He played the flute all day, and the sound can be heard a few miles away.
Meanwhile, the sorrowing Dayang found it hard to forget Jurai. She misses him so much. At one night, she heard someone playing a flute from afar. She knew it was Jurai. She became hysterical. And by dawn, Dayang left the village and ran off to look for the Tapang Tree. The good spirit changed her into a bee, and it flew up to the Tapang Tree. Jurai, who saw the bee, was curious. Then his grandmother spirit told him that the bee turned out to be Dayang.
It had been months after the incident. Jurai still stayed near the tapang tree and making honey harvesting as his source of income. Many people, including traders, liked to buy his honey. He also used the honey as remedies to cure sickness among the villagers. He was well known as Tukang Mabu.
From the village, there was a king named Raja Magan who ruled the Bidayuh land. He has a daughter named Putri Jina who is suffering from a mysterious illness that made her lie down all the time, and her condition was getting worse day by day. Raja Mangan was so worried about his daughter's condition. He tried various ways to cure the illness, but none have worked. And one day, he went over to Jurai's mother's longhouse.
Bye.
Raja Manggung made an important announcement. Any man who could cure his daughter would be rewarded with wealth and could marry his daughter.
The news spread and reached the villagers who knows Jurai. They quickly looked for Jurai and suggested him to try his luck. Jurai agreed and went to the tapang tree to ask for a blessing from the grandmother Nukit and Tai.
So off Jurai went to Raja Manggung's kingdom. He introduced himself and offered to heal Putri Jina. Jurai prepared the honey remedy and gave it to Putri Jina. He continued doing this for days and nights. On the seventh day, Putri Jina could sit by herself and has fully recovered from the mysterious illness.
Putri Jina had fell in love with Jurai. Raja Manggung was pleased with Jurai's character and appointed him to be his right person. Not far from the kingdom lived Sanau, Raja Manggung's right person and a warrior. He has his eyes on Putri Jina and wanted to marry her. But when Raja Manggung had announced that Jurai would marry Putri Jina, he made a plan to kidnap her. One night, while the villagers were asleep, Sana and his men went to kidnap Putri Jina. When Hirai heard about this, he immediately looked for Putujina and killed Sanao and his men.
Jurai have rescued Putri Jinang and brought her back to the longhouse. All the villagers, including Raja Manggen, were delighted to see Putri Jinang safe.
Soon, a marriage between Jurai and Putujinang is about to take place. They have invited guests from all corners of the earth to share in their joy of becoming husband and wife.
It is going to be the grandest royal wedding ceremony.
Thank you.
couple dance happily together with the guests as they celebrate the joy of love and victory of Jurai and Puchichina in these 7 days, 7 nights. Together with his wife and the villagers. They start the Kawai celebration with a special ritual, Tola Bara. The elders would start performing the ritual at Bawar, a very special platform or altar on a nearby stream. They would chant the traditional prayers to give thanks to the spirit and perform the ritual dances asking for a bountiful harvest the following season.
It is Gawai time in the longhouse. It was painted by the various communities in Sarawak and came from overseas, where they were entertained to food and drinks and also cultural performances.
The Bidayuh community regards Gawai Sawa as the biggest and the grandest of all Gawai. It marks the end of the harvesting season.
During this time, all of Jurai's descendants know the story of the honey and the tapang tree. Jurai has taught them to sing the honey song, Mikumba. Jurai's descendants enjoy their ancestors' sweet legacy until this very day. Cerita hati jadi suto di atas kakale asal si Jurai udip ibu bah sebab
mandi dan sejuruhan. Ayo dok hina kena susah. Cerita hati jadi suto di atas. Kadale asar sejuruhan. Macam kerja mi anu ayah dapat jubangis. Lalu si juran dah dagangin dua jubangis di serata reis. Sampai cukup jadi tim megah sampai anu hati.
Ladies and gentlemen, this has been the presentation from the Sarawak Cultural Village in conjunction with the World Harvest Festival 2017
with the musical drama
Tra-Tra-Land, where honey sparkles.
The musical drama was conceptualized by Jamie Alaba, festival director Zaini Haji Saidi.
Original story by Heidi Munan and Dawa.
Script adaptation and head of community.
Artistic director Osman Hassan.
Choreographer Martina Benedicto. Coaches Komalagya and Saleha Bohari.
Prop master and set by Jacqueline Jella, Richie Manning, Daud Odin, Wilfred Kuat and Wan Termizi.
Set and costume design Bruna Hipni and Muhammad Hatidi.
Costume setup and artist coordination Tuna Hibni, Noraisha, Muhammad Hadidi and Florence Cindy.
Set and backdrop Daniel Alem, Jacqueline Chella and Sarawak Cultural Village Engineering Team. Music director and coordinator Johari Moshidi and Abdul Rahman.
Technical director Richie Ramil. Music arrangement by Jerry Cummins.
Lighting and sound, Sarawak Cultural Village, technicians, SLDN apprentices, and Les Paul. Shooting, follow spots and special effects, Hasman Gerardi, Norlida Pujang, Ahmad Tramizi, and SLDN apprentices.
Tra-Tra-Land, where honey sparkles, was performed by the artists of Sarawak Cultural Village, SLDN apprentices, and the students of Sekolah Seni Kuching.
Narration by Gary Hanif
and Nizali Becky.
We wish everyone
Selamat Gawai Daya.
Tra-Tra-Land, Osi Jura.